Okay, so I think I'll start with a couple of words and then introduce Ray. Ray, you can take off your mask when you're talking. Yes, okay. As soon as these people come in and get checked in, I'm going to ask the board members to come up. Couple things I want to remind you, turn your clocks back tomorrow night. The end of daylight saving, the end of daylight savings time, right? Yeah, but before you go to bed tomorrow night, Fleming Museum tomorrow, for those of you going, there is an echo, isn't there? 12:30, right, be there at 12:30. Winter lights, I think you got an email on that. That's December 15th at 5, and feel free to get your tickets. I think there's still plenty, but you don't want to wait too long to do that if you want to join us. Turn off your cell phones. And I did want to tell you that this is the last program of the fall series. I know. We wanted to end with a bang. And I think we're doing it. I wanted to let you know that we will start up our spring semester on February 17th. And then we'll go until April 28th. So we're going to have 10 lectures. We're working our way up. 9 lectures now, 10 lectures in the spring. Should I be trying a different microphone? Hello? Back? Hello? Can you hear? Oh, that's me then. Sorry about that. So sorry. And I want to thank you all for your support, because without you, we wouldn't be here. I did want to ask the board to come up so I can introduce them to you and have you thank them. So come on up, please. This is a terrific board. We would not have gotten through without this board. I love this board. It's been a lot of hard work, I have to tell you. Is that far enough, Dan? Are you still here? Okay. It's been a lot of hard work to bring this to you. I hope you like this format. We are planning on continuing with the same format next spring. So people that want to Zoom from home should do that. And we love them, every one of you. Okay, this is our board. This is Kathy Chamberlain. She's our treasurer. She pays our bills, thank goodness. Then the next one is Cindy Mackin, who has two hats. She's vice president. She's co-chair of the program committee. Then we have Mary Ellen Bridge, who's I think our newest member. And she's chairing the website committee, which is a standing committee that we've just formed. So we want to upgrade our website. That's in the future. Then we have Betty Navin. You've seen emails from her. She's our special events chair. So she's organized all these little outdoor things tomorrow, winter lights. We love that. We wanted to give you some outdoor events when we were all worried about being indoors. Next, we have Kathy Ryan. She is our secretary, and don't we go on at our board meetings. And how she manages to write this all down, I have no idea. And then we have Linda Sparks, who has two hats. She is co-chair of membership committee and also chair of the nominating committee. And I want to mention Glenn Roa. I hope you're watching, Glenn. We miss you. He is watching on Zoom. He is co-chair of membership. You know, he's the one that keeps all our membership data, sends out all the emails. We could not survive without him. So a big round of applause for these people. Thank you. What? And then there's Travis. Travis Washington. He's not on the board, though. He would not like our board meetings. Too much verbiage. But we love you, and thank you, Travis. Okay, let me introduce Ray, because this is going to be fun. Lots of fun. He grew up in South Bronx, immersed in the heart of two vibrant New York City music scenes, jazz and salsa. Ray established himself as an educator, mentor, and innovator in the international jazz and Latin music scenes, and has performed and recorded with many great legends. He was lured to Vermont as a guest artist at the Flynn Jazz Summer Camp in the early 2000s. The University of Vermont offered Ray a position as a senior lecturer in 2008 and was the first creative artist at UVM to be awarded the distinguished title of University Scholar for 2015, to 2016. He also was the Herb Lockwood Prize. The Herb Lockwood Prize as a person who has elevated their art form and created a community of artists working at a higher level in Vermont. And of course, now Ray has a platform at Vermont Public with Friday Night Jazz. In addition, he regularly plays among town at various locales such as the Hotel Vermont. We're lucky to have him. Please welcome Ray Vega.
Hello. Do you hear me well? Back there in the peanut gallery, as they used to call it in the old days. You guys are good back there? Alrighty. So one thing you left out was that in the height of the pandemic, I was given the honor of Arts Educator of the Year by the Vermont Arts Council. So that was pretty nice. That was pretty cool. Okay, so this subject is kind of wide open, and I always let people know that what I'm going to share today has a lot of fact behind it, but a lot of it is also my take and my opinion on many of these issues. Because for instance, when people start talking about the origin or the roots of one thing or another, there are going to be a lot of different opinions associated with the subject matter. So I just let folks know that this is my opinion, and I base my opinion on the many discussions that I've had with many of the individuals that we will discuss today. So the session today is the roots of Latin jazz. Okay, so we have this question: what is Latin jazz? Well, it's a very popular form of jazz right now in the United States and worldwide that combines elements of jazz, improvisation. Shush back there. No, now I'm acting like an old school teacher. Did you bring enough candy for everybody else? No, I'm just kidding. I'm so bad. I do that to my kids at school. Hi, kids. Anyway, so with the subject of Latin jazz, it's a very popular form of jazz today, played worldwide. I've played with Latin jazz groups in Greece, in Latin jazz groups in Beirut, Lebanon, Latin jazz groups in Japan. The music is quite popular now, but it does have some roots that can be addressed. Now, I'm going to keep an eye on the time because I know that we're limited time because of television. Oh, that sounds so interesting. We're limited time because of television. This is brought to you by Geritol. No. No, what was my favorite one? What was this? So, no, I used to watch all those shows, Ted Mack's Amateur Hour. You wouldn't know anything about that. Anybody remember that? Come on, my people. Yes. So, yes. Oh, yes. Hi there. Do you hear me better now?
Yes.
Okay, sorry. Hello back there. How are you? Hey, awesome. All right, so do you hear me better?
Yes.
Oh, that's awesome. That's fantastic. I hear me better too. Anyway, so I always do a little bit of back history on this music. Now, what I'm going to do is this. I'm going to play you a couple of different things. I'm just going to jump from one thing to another. I'm going to jump from this thing. I'm going to start right here. This is Fletcher Henderson's band. This is in the 1920s. Who was Fletcher Henderson? Fletcher Henderson was an African-American band leader based in New York City, had the opportunity in the mid-1920s to be one of the first, if not the first, Black band to perform at New York's Roseland, trading off with an all-white band. Roseland was located at 50th Street between 8th and between 7th and or Broadway and 8th Avenue. It's the backstage faces the backstage area to where they do the Stephen Colbert show or the Ed Sullivan Theater. But anyway, that was a major dance hall. It's no longer there. It was tore down recently. But Fletcher Henderson's band was a very popular band in New York City and in the genre of what was known then as like hot jazz. It was the 1920s. It was the roaring 20s. And his band was quite popular. And they sounded like this. Can you hear that? Shall I raise it up? That's he's so by many standards, when I play for folks that are like really young kids, they kind of listen to that and they go, well, that sounds like really old music. And it just kind of reminds me of when I was a young kid watching The Little Rascals. That's a lot of this stuff reminds me of. But that was the sound of the music at the time. So when I start speaking about the roots of Latin jazz, I always say, well, there are some things that happened before this kind of Latin jazz term started to get floated around in the industry. Why did I play with Fletcher Henderson? Well, the tubist in the band, and yes, there's a tuba there, not a bass player. If I'll put it from the beginning, you'll hear the, oh, there goes that little thing again. Oh, no, it's okay. It's all good. It's all good. It's just a little, you'll hear the. That boom, boom, boom. So the tuba was the bass of its time in the world of jazz. Jazz bands didn't use a string bass yet. The string bass as you would do in an orchestra. They use a tuba or a bass saxophone. So the tuba in this band was a gentleman named Rafael Escudero from Puerto Rico. Now, was he playing Latin jazz? No. He was playing jazz in New York City as we knew it with the top band in New York at the time playing this type of music. Okay, is it Latin music? No, but it's a gentleman from Puerto Rico playing a major role in the sound of the rhythm of that band. That's all. Okay, now I'm going to go to another individual. And you don't have to take notes. There's no exam tomorrow. Don't worry. There's no exam. Okay, so then I go to another very important group that developed in the latter part of the 1920s in New York City, led by none other than the great Duke Ellington. And this is a conversation. Caravan. It's written by Monty Zoll from Puerto Rico, who was living in Washington, D.C., and befriended Duke and came up to New York with Duke Ellington. And he was from Puerto Rico. But is he there? He wrote the composition. And he was a wonderful loud trombonist. And at the bridge, you'll hear him play the beautiful melody. The big hits for the Ellington Orchestra, written by this gentleman from Puerto Rico. Now, it might have had kind of a Latin-ish kind of sound, but it didn't have any traditional Latin instruments in the rhythm section. It was just a drummer. And this makes a lot of folks really uncomfortable. But at this period, when Duke was performing at the Cotton Club in New York, he was given the title of King of Jungle Music. You can't make this stuff up, but it was because that's how they sold it. And it was a very popular kind of selling point. Remember, the Cotton Club was an institution in Harlem where all of the servers were black. The dancers were, the women that danced were all light-skinned black women. They did not, if you were a darker-skinned black woman, you were probably not going to work as a dancer at the Cotton Club. So all the servers were servers and the band was all black, but you could only be white to go to this place. It was not an interracial room. It was entertainment for whites only. But anyway, but Duke put together a band. They worked at the Cotton Club for many years, and he used that time to write new compositions constantly to showcase the dance routines that they would have at that establishment. And then he went on to become the Duke Ellington that we know today. That's just unspeakable. I mean, just the body of work is immense. So we have Fletcher Henderson, Duke Ellington, two major bands. I'm going to kind of move this quickly, and then I'm going to go over to a group called the International Sweethearts of Rhythm. Now, this is an all-women's jazz big band, all-women's jazz big band. And why did that happen in the 19, during the swing era, especially during World War II? Because many men were drafted. And so people wanted to hear music, and it was somewhat, it was a novelty to have an all-women's band, although it was a novelty, but a lot of male musicians felt uncomfortable with the fact that this all-women's band sounded like this.
And now, fellow members of Hutton Hall, the Sweethearts of Rhythm are going to nail up a nocturne that will make you knit one and purl a couple. And if there are any squares digging this concert and jump, I'll translate that paraphrase to wit. 17 groovy gals are going to light the fuse to a fast fugie. The Jim Neal special. Sprinklers, girls. Sprinklers.
Sounds like a great big band to me. I don't care what the shit is. The International Sweethearts of Rhythm important in this conversation about what's going to become known as Latin jazz? Well, a couple of things that was important about this band. It wasn't until the mid-40s that bands in the swing era bands, the bands that we love, the Dorsey, the Miller bands and all of that. By and large, these bands were not integrated. They were not integrated. Duke Ellington's band was all black, but even when he filmed in the Amos and Andy movie, Check and Double Check, two members of his band who were a little lighter than me in complexion had to get blackface so that people wouldn't perceive that they were had an interracial band. One of them that got blackface was Juan Tizol, along with Barney Bigard, a Creole from New Orleans, but they had to get blackface. So these bands were not interracial for the most part. International Sweethearts of Rhythm was an interracial band. That was like, so they were ahead of the thing. And another thing that was interesting about them, they had these two sisters from El Barrio, from East Harlem in New York, what we call Spanish Harlem, the Bayron sisters from Puerto Rico. One played alto sax in that band and the other one played trombone in that band. And so again, now so what I'm getting at is like, you've got this great jazz music being created in New York, and you've got a lot of important, like you have Hispanic or Latino figures in these groups. It doesn't sound like Latin music yet. But now the last group that I'm going to touch on is this one. This is really old. This is from 1990. Group that you're listening to, and of course, I got to keep it moving. This is all of this stuff. You can find all of this music online, and if any of you want to reach me, you can reach me through my college email address, and I'll be more than happy to answer questions. So what you heard was the Memphis Blues, performed by James Reese Europe and the 369th Infantry Band from Harlem. Now, why are they important? They were the first band to travel to Europe as military men. Most, every base in the United States will have a band that's associated with that particular unit. So the unit in Harlem had this group, and it was led by James Reese Europe, who was the most sought after orchestra leader in New York, who presented music for the richest of New York, the Vanderbilts, the Pucks, all of those folks from like the Gilded Age, who had that great money all through the 1870s, 80s, 90s, et cetera, into the early part of the 20th century, when it was a lot of money. Well, he performed the big parties for them. So when the time came that I believe it was around 1914, maybe 15, the folks in Harlem, they went to the governor of New York and they said, we need our own unit based in Harlem. So when they did that, they went and got James Reese Europe, who was already an established orchestra leader. Now, when James Reese Europe, they got him to be the bandmaster of that unit. When they hired him, where did he go? Well, he obviously put together a band of great musicians that he was working with. But through his connection with Rafael Escudero, the tubist who would eventually in the 1920s be playing with Fletcher Henderson's band, well, they had worked together before that. And James Reese Europe went to Puerto Rico, in 1917, right after the Jones Act, and he went and he got 19 members of his band that played this music. 19 members of them were from Puerto Rico. Now, were they playing music from Puerto Rico? No, they were playing, this band played a mixture of plantation songs and old spirituals, along with American marches and French marches. When they went to France, they also were involved in military campaigns, to the point they were so successful that the people of France dubbed them the Harlem Hellfighters, or the Hellfighters. And they received an honor that is only given to French citizens, which is the Croix de Guerre, all of them. But so if you join the army today and you want to play in a band, you probably will not see any action. Not these guys. This is an all-Black unit mixed with Afro-Puerto Ricans, and they went and they fought. But these guys were like the first people to go to Europe, the European continent, and play this thing that wasn't called jazz yet, but it was a mixture of the blues, ragtime music, spirituals, etc. And they played these marches unlike no marches were ever played before. People were used to hearing like the John Philip Sousa style of marches. These guys are coming out doing like, you know, instead of, well, I would imitate it on trumpet, but I didn't bring it. But they changed it up. They changed the phrasing of it. But I always go back and go, well, you know, a big part of that group was 19 guys were from Puerto Rico, including one guy, Rafael Hernandez, who's one of the most important composers of Puerto Rican music. Now you say, what does this have to do with the way that these folks are going to play, these young folks? Let me just play you something here, man. Let me give you something here. A little something. Big band. Or something that sounds like this. Brazil with jazz. Dominican Republic. It's a very popular traditional Dominican song. They've kind of redone it in a more modern jazz style. Simon. And this is one of the great standards from Venezuela, Alma Yanet. Looking like jazz musicians, but it's got this other kind of rhythmic feel to it. Now I just want to make sure I'm moving in time so that I don't mess. All right, I got to get moving here. Okay, so now I'm going to get off from this. And I'm going to go, now how can I center this? I'm going to move this over this way. Wait a minute. Hold it. I'm just not computer savvy. Oh, my God. Help me. There it is. All righty. Okay, so I'm going to move really quickly. Read it. So what happened was this, in the latter part of the 1940s, there had already been large communities of Hispanics already living in New York City by the time this time. But a really neat thing happened at the latter part of the 1940s. They opened up a Birdland, which is a jazz club, was open on 52nd Street and Broadway. And the place was named after Charlie Parker, Bird. So they opened up in 49. Next door to that was a place called the Palladium on 53rd Street and Broadway. So what would happen between sets there, musicians would go from the Latin bands, would go down here, Basie or Thelonious Monk or Dizzy Gillespie. And when those guys, the Gillespies and those guys were on break, they went up to the Palladium and listened to Machito or Tito Rodriguez or Tito Puente. So that kind of stuff started to go on. But was that the beginning of it? No, that was just the thing that helped to explode what would be known as the Mambo craze, which kind of happened at a good time. And the reason why I say this is because by the latter part of the 1940s, big bands in general, it was very difficult to keep those guys on the road working. So big band, and also, you know, rock and roll starts coming into play. So people's tastes and interests start to change. But there are still people that love to dance. Oh my God, I want to dance. So a lot of these folks, and they didn't wait until the latter part of the 1940s to check out Latin music. They were already going up to the clubs up in Harlem that were presenting Latin music, the music of Joe Loco, to Machito, et cetera. So as far as like folks checking out Latin music, that was not necessarily a new thing. It had been happening all through the 1930s, all through the 40s, but it kind of blew up at that point. The latter part of the 40s is when some really beautiful things started to happen. Big bands took a major hit, but people still wanted to dance, and they were drawn. Since the 1930s, America was drawn to Latin culture when it came to that exotic thing, whether it was Carmen Miranda or Ricky Ricardo. Now, I know everybody knows you, Ricky Ricardo, and everybody remembers. If I mention this and you don't know it, I'm going to walk out of here really upset. But remember Mrs. Manicotti on the Jackie Gleason show that she was learning how to mambo? Oh, Carlos is going to teach you how to dance the mambo. That was pop culture. Everybody was learning. What was that guy? Arthur Murray was teaching people how to mambo. Oh, it looked terrible. Okay, you danced like that. He was terrible, but people would go see Arthur Murray's footsteps for mambo. It was huge. At the same time, you know what happened was there was a thing changing. Interest started to change, but people wanted to dance. All during the development of what we call jazz through the even the latter part of the teens into the 20s, into the 30s, what made it so popular? It was a party music. It was a dance music. People wanted to dance. Why was ragtime so popular? Because it was a dance music, and it was nothing like those Victorian mores that were happening before that. This was like, you know, okay, I'm going to dance clothes, and that's what drove the parents crazy. So ragtime was about dancing. The roaring 20s, that was about dancing. That was about partying onto a different level, a whole different. So people want to dance. And when bebop came into the place of like the more popular music after the swinger, a lot of people go, well, it sounds great, but I can't really dance to it. You know, I can't really dance to it. So this thing is an important. So do I hit a button to move my slides? There it is. Oh no, where are my sound samples? They're not here. All of my sound samples are gone. Oh my goodness. I don't see them. I don't see them on my screen. Oh my goodness. Oh, this is really bizarre. Will you please bear with me, television folks? Okay, so this gentleman's really important. You can read time-wise. Oh God, Ray, move. Oh, I gotta move it. Okay, let me focus my thoughts. Okay, So this gentleman's really important. He was a child prodigy clarinetist when he came to New York in the mid-1920s in the height of the Harlem Renaissance. And I had the honor of working with Mario in 92. And that was the first time that he did a tour with his own band. We went to Europe, but I got to work with him. Now, he came to New York playing clarinet. He was a clarinetist. He played principal clarinet with La Orquesta Sinfónica de La Habana, the Havana Symphony Orchestra. He was a child prodigy musician. He came to New York at 14 years old, and this is the way he described it to me. He never called me Ray. He called me Vega. No Vega. Vega! And he goes, Vega! Harlem was a paradise. Vega, Harlem was a paradise. He goes, I never saw anything quite like that. He goes, the cops were black, the doctors were black, the lawyers were black, the librarian was black, the school teachers were black, and you had a mixture of people that just came in from the South trying to get their act together, but living next door to, you know, a Marion and Anderson's family or something like that, people that were very established. So it was like it gave folks that were coming in from the Deep South, or in his case, a black man coming from Cuba, it gave him like a whole look at like, wow, this is really amazing. And oh my God, the possibilities. Well, he came to New York first playing. Well, let me see if my sound sample works. No, let's see if it works now. So he came back to New York a couple of years later with a band playing Son Cubano, which is Son Cubano is like the kind of music that was focused on in the documentary called Buena Vista Social Club, which is an older dance music that is the roots of what we call salsa today. Well, the trumpet player in a band that was going to come to New York to record could not make the trip. And Mario went to the band leader and he tells him, you got a trumpet? Give me the music. I'll learn it. You're a clarinetist. Doesn't matter. I'll learn it. This is like, you wouldn't believe this. But Mario was very well trained as a musician. He could solfege anything. He could sight read anything. You know, he could read different clefs. He was brilliant. So he says, I'll get it. So then he comes back with them and he's playing trumpet now and doing this. Oh, I hope this works. Two things happening at the same time. I just can't see any of all of my music. Let me see if this works. This is very bizarre. Oh man, I had no idea. This ate up all of my sound samples. So I can't access any of them. Let me see if I could do that, but then I'm going to lose the streamers. Yeah, these. That's what I want to see.
There you go.
That's what I want to see. So bear with me. Let's open up this page just a little bit. Isn't technology lovely? It is, isn't it? Oh, I can do that. Yes. Oh my God. I hope I can switch gears here. Yes, there we go. Yes, I'll make it work quick. We might go over, sorry. We might go over, you're gonna have to edit all this out, okay? Okay, so then he came back playing song, which sounded like this. I'm staying in New York. His intention was, yeah, I'm going to go to New York to record. I'll see you guys later. I'm staying here. 3 years later, he's playing first trumpet, not third. He's playing lead trumpet with Chick Webb's band. At the time, Chick Webb was considered the king of swing in New York and at the Savoy Ballroom. Remember, Chick Webb is Mario actually discovered Ella Fitzgerald, young vocalist. He was there when she won the award at the Apollo Theater, and he went to Chick Webb and said, "You need to check this lady out." So now he went to play this. Just a couple of years later, playing this. Now, why is this important? Well, he goes and he does this. Oh, come on now, switch now. Oh, now we want to. Now to move to the next slide. Wait a minute, hold it. I'm going to have to do this in order to move my slides. It won't. Yeah, this is bad. Now I'm trying to move to the next slide and I can't do it. Sorry about that. There it is.
Hitting over here.
Well, believe me, if you can't read what's the. Yeah, okay, excellent.
It's just over on
the. It's over on the side. Sorry, my bad. Nobody says my bad anymore. So then Mario gets together with his brother-in-law, Frank Grillo, better known as Machito, and they say, let's put together a band. We're in New York. We got the best musicians. This band's going to have an all Latin rhythm section, but on top of it, we're going to put jazz on top. So it's going to change the sound of what this music is going to be like. It's good. There's Latin bands in New York already, but they're playing nothing like what we're going to come out doing. We're going to take the sound of the American big band, but put those Afro-Cuban rhythms under it. They called the band Machito and his Afro-Cubans, and this band gave everybody the opportunity to kind of like, meaning the listeners and the dancers, it gave them a lot of options.
A la rumba entela, con tela, sin tela.
And the band also featured Gracie over here, Graciela, the great vocalist. It was commonplace in big bands to have what they called the boy singer and the girl singer. That was very common. It was very, it sold the product. Yeah, people wanted to go here. People loved to go and see Glenn Miller, but they loved it when Tex Beneke got up and sang Chattanooga Choo Choo because it was a sellable thing. So Gracie, as we called her name was Graciela, but we called her Gracie. She was the may have been doing this kind of music, but it did sound like this. Machito, who sang the male vocals. You got Gracie. She's got the beautiful ballads, and she would sing a lot of tunes that had like a double meaning, a double entendre, kind of, you know, kind of dirty, kind of joking. But they loved her. She was awesome. And I'll tell you one thing. I worked with her in the early 90s, and she would go around, they would bring around a wheelchair, and then she'd get up on stage and sing, put her back in a wheelchair, and she could drink any guy under the table. She was like a sailor. She wasn't going to take anything from any. She was like, boom. It was like, girlfriend. You got it. I always have a special place in my heart for Gracie. But she was very important in that band. Everybody was looking for Graciela, or as we call her, Gracie. So you get the male singer, you get the boy singer, the girl singer. Then he would do the same thing, instrumental. That's where he featured members of the band, great jazz, and the band was just there's more improvisation on that, but I do have to move along. Sorry about that, folks. You can edit all this, right? Thank you, son. Thank you. Isn't he awesome? Give it up for Travis. Now, wait a minute.
Mambo.
Mambo. Ala Savoy.
Mambo.
Mambo. Ala Savoy.
Mambo.
Mambo. Ala Savoy.
Mambo.
Mambo. Ala Savoy.
Mambo.
It's not a fan, the real sensation. Let's do it, you can do it too. It was started by a Latin who brought the dance to all Manhattan, and he called it Mambo a la Savoy.
Dulce como rapa dura, mueve negra tu cintura.
He's not singing in English now, he's singing in Spanish. The audiences didn't care. The audience were like drawn to it. So you could have the singer singing kind of like the swing style of vocal harmony, quartet, and then Macho would sing his part. Now, I want you to kind of listen to this. And the first person who raises their hand will be a very special person. So listen to this. Why would they play Habanagila? Because they would play up at the Jewish resorts. I played at the Concord with Tito Puente's band, and that was a completely kosher house. And yeah, but the resorts don't exist anymore. It's so sad. The Italian resorts don't. Well, Villa Roma still exists, but the other ones in the Catskills, then they're all gone. And this is a place that families. Jewish families would come up with their whole family. They'd spend weeks and weeks up there. They had tennis courts. They had pools. They had, if you chose to do the whole kosher thing, you could do that. But it was awesome. But these folks like to dance the mambo. End of story. With all my travels, with Mario, not so much, because we were mostly doing jazz things. But when I was with Tito Puente, those folks, we would come out, and it was like the audiences would come out, and they'd go, Tito, oh my God, Tito. And that was the lady talking to Tito. I want you, Tito. You know, cigarettes. You could do that back then. You know, and they knew Tito from when, and these women and men were dancing 3-4 nights a week, and they looked awesome. Cardiovascular. So they were dancing. But Macho started this thing. And the thing is that he's going to start bringing a lot of jazz solos because big bands are not going to be working as much. And a lot of the solos with those big bands need to get work. So he got, for instance, Doc Cheatham, who subbed for Louis Armstrong on many bands in Chicago. He had Leslie Jonikins on baritone saxophone that played with all the black jazz big bands in Harlem. It was a mixture, but he started to get a lot of great soloists. So now these guys are playing their jazz stuff over the Latin thing. So think about Machito. What is he giving you? He's giving you the vocals by a man and a woman, boy and girl singer. He's giving you the thing that the big bands did that. He's giving you something else that the big bands did. Great melodies so you could hear the improvisation and follow. Maybe you didn't want to dance. Maybe you just wanted to see Harry James playing with Benny Goodman's band. That's what you wanted to see. So it was the same thing, but the rhythms were different and people were dancing to it. And it was the craze of the time. Now I'm gonna move. Oh, here you go. I gotta do this. Where am I? Yes, bear with me, folks. Don't laugh. You laugh, I will walk over and kick you. No, I do this all the time. I'm almost there. Wait a minute, hold it. Oh my God, where am I? Oh my God, technology. Oy vey. Oh my God, where am I? Oh my God. Wait a minute. Hold it. Everything's lost here. Wait a minute. Ah, there we go. Sorry. So then now, what happens here? This is part of the direction where the jazz starts to marry this thing. Dizzy Gillespie goes to Mario Bauza. They knew each other on Cab Calloway's band. And he got Dizzy on Cab Calloway's band, Mario Bauza did. And so Dizzy, being the great bebop innovator, he goes to Mario and he tells him, look, I'm looking for something a little bit different because the rhythms that we use in jazz are very limited. But you guys in the Latin bands, you've got all this other percussive stuff happening and I want to make a mixture of my thing with that. So he was the first jazz musician to actually put a set of these things, the conga drums. Remember that? That's what Ricky Ricardo was supposed to be playing, but he didn't really play, but he did do that thing. Anybody remember I Love Lucy? Come on. Nobody remembers. Everybody here saw I Love Lucy at least once or twice. Please put your hands up. Stop acting like you didn't, of course. So what Dizzy did was he took this guy. Better yet, this is what Dizzy Gillespie's band sounded like when they played bebop. Bebop. It's not dance. But he says, hey, but I want to do some other things. So then he wound up doing things like this. Mambeca! Mambeca! Dizzy's band with a cold player. Nobody has done that before. Conga playing of Chano Pozo on that hadn't been done before. Everything before that was like maybe all Latin or all swing or like a Duke Ellington thing where they're kind of playing Latin-esque type of rhythm, but to have that actual conga drum there changed the game. I'm going to move it quickly because we do it's okay. I'm going to fix these when I get home. Don't you say anything. Don't you laugh. I heard you. Okay. Then you have this situation. The great Chico Farrell from Cuba. He originally comes to the States because, well, he goes to boarding school in the States. And he's a trumpeter and he's a lover of big band music, writing for Benny. He wrote for Benny Goodman's band. He arranged for Basie's, Count Basie's band. But then he was commissioned. This was probably the first major commission after the first, I think, major commission in jazz was probably Paul Whiteman going to George Gershwin for the Rhapsody in Blue, because that was a commission that Paul Whiteman, the band leader, did with George Gershwin. So he went, so now the record label, Verve Records, Norman Granz goes to Chico Farrow and he says, I want you to write something that's going to feature the Machito Orchestra, but it's going to feature some of our jazz artists that are traveling on our thing called the, what did they call it? They called it, oh my God, Jazz at the Philharmonic, which is a big thing. Jazz at the Philharmonic was a way, it was a traveling road show that a jazz band would go to a stage of a Philharmonic hall and they would have a major jam session featuring older musicians and younger musicians. And it was a very popular thing. It was a very popular thing. So then they go to Chico O'Farrell, Maestro Chico, and they tell him, we want you to write something. So he wrote this piece called the Afro-Cuban Jazz Suite. It's 17 minutes long. I will not play it, but I will give you an idea of some of the stuff that it sounded like. Now, This is Mango Mangue, which is like a Cuban tune, but check this out. Remember the swing bands with all those Latinos in it? Then you had Latin bands, but not as a combination of the two things, and taking the jazz improvisation elements of it and putting it on top of that foundation with the Latin rhythms. And the bottom line is that, unlike bebop, which I'm a major lover of, this stuff is very danceable and a little more accessible to a lot of listeners, because they're going, I can actually dance to this thing. Okay, so I'm going to move on, because I know we have questions and the time is, she's running away, right? Yes, give me that look. Sorry. I will make it quickly. Okay, I'm going to probably play less music. And then I'll probably end off with this gentleman here. I'll end off with him, Ernest Anthony. He's a gentleman that I had a chance to play with. What Puente brought to this situation was, he was the first like Latin band leader to take the whole showmanship to a completely different place. And he wanted to do everything the way the Machito did it. So he would do things like this. Just like Machito did the same thing. Now, what do we have here? No, I'm not gonna do that yet. You would record all these great female vocals for the Vicelia Cruz, for La Lupe, but he wanted to have that boleros for the audiences and the dancers. To do that, then he wanted to do
Thank you.
on that. No singing at all. That was the last thing I heard. Then he wanted to do large works, like what Jimmy Farrell did with Dizzy and with Dizzy Gillespie. But instead of him getting another arranger, Tito did the arranging himself. He was well, I mean, he was a drummer. People saw him and said, oh, this guy's not going to. He was a well-rounded musician. Now, I would like to play more of that, but I'll give you an example of how we would start a show when I was in the band. This is something that I recorded with Tito in 93, right? So what did these bands do? They took the great elements of jazz, they took the great elements of Afro-Caribbean music, and they went like this. And that started here. Were there bands in Cuba playing music with improvisation? Sure they were, but they weren't really playing jazz improvisational. They were doing more typical of what was done with that type of music. They were not jazz improvisers. They were improvising, but they weren't speaking the language of bebop. And so I always go to these guys as like, they were the ones who started this thing that led the way for so many other people, like myself included, to be able to live from. So from that, we're going to go to questions. And I'm really sorry that it went over. Oh, that we started late, right? Yes. Okay. Sorry, folks. I would do it faster. We're going to do part two next year. I'm so bad. Any questions?
Questions?
There you go, right over here. I came all the way by the airport. I live by the airport. Be nice to me. There's a microphone.
The only requirement for part two is bring your trumpet.
Definitely.
The question is, at the beginning of your talk, you made it clear to me why the Preservation Hall bassist also played tuba.
Bingo. Yes.
Is it common for a musician to be able to do a string instrument as well as?
It's funny you should bring that up, because Ralph Escudero, who played tuba with the band, eventually had to switch over to string bass. So many of the tubists that played in the early swing bands wound up, they didn't call it swing then. They just called it the music of the 1920s. They called it hot jazz. But the rhythm section, there was no bass in the band. It was tuba. So as things started to change from the 20s into the 30s, it became that thing from boom, 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 to dunk, 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 dunk. There's a great band leader in New York named Vince Giordano and the Nighthawks, and they have like a regular thing in New York, and they present music from that period, and he plays bass sax, tuba, and string bass, and he sings as well. So when he's playing the string bass, he can sing, and they play all of those old recordings, or rather all those old arrangements of Gene Golket's band, of Fletcher Henderson, Ellington, etc. But you hear that tuba. The tuba was the rhythm, was the bottom of the rhythm section. Yes.
Anyone else? One more.
Thank you, Ray. Could you demonstrate the mambo?
Maybe after a couple of drinks.
Oh, well, next time we'll bring Bloody Mary.
Yeah. We'll do. Yeah, no. But it's, I won't do it. It'll get documented and I will never live it down.
Okay. Well, this has been such fun. What a great way to end our program.
Wait a minute. I came all the way from South Burlington. Oh, we were in South Burlington. Sorry. So no questions. Like, Ray, what's your favorite color? Oh, my God. Anyway, nobody online with any questions?
No.
Yeah. I only play the trumpet. And I play trumpets in trumpets, other related trumpets, like the flugelhorn and the cornet. And more so when I was in New York, where I was like, I would play piccolo trumpet and E flat and D trumpet. Because I made, when I was in New York, I made a living as a commercial musician, which meant that I had to play whatever they called me to do. So whether it was a brass quintet playing at somebody's wedding or doing a recording session for toothpaste or playing in a dance. So I just played, and I'm classically trained. So I just, that was the thing. But I mostly play trumpet. If you see me now, I play trumpet and flugelhorn. That's what you'll see me playing at my regular gigs at like the Hotel Vermont, which is my regular Wednesday night gig. And I'm playing at the something called a Venetian Soda Room this Saturday from 7 to 9. I'm glad it's ending at 9 so I can still get some sleep when I get home, because I don't do good late. So no more questions.
Right here.
Oh, wait, yeah. So wait. So does anybody remember? Oh, the questions back there?
Mm-hmm.
Oh, good. I'm so sorry.
Now, it's not really a question. I just wanted to say that I grew up in West Virginia back in the 50s, and our senior class trip was to New York City. And that night, our sponsors had arranged for us to go to a place called Birdland.
Birdland.
And
yes,
we didn't know what Birdland was, and we didn't know anything about this kind of music. But we took it all back home to West Virginia, and we had lots of fun.
You're going to Birdland, or you went to Birdland?
Went to Birdland.
Oh, yeah, it's a great club.
Yeah, but that was back in 1956.
Oh, that was the real Birdland. Oh, that was the real Birdland. It's not the fancy schmancy place it is now.
No. It wasn't fancy schmancy at all.
Oh, no.
It was just fun. No. But it opened up a whole new world to my whole class.
Wow.
From West Virginia, 56.
Oh, that was a prime time.
Fun. Thank you so much. This is terrific.